to order the Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board meeting for December the 16th, 1997. The first order of business is the minutes of the previous meeting dated November the 18th, 1997. Does anybody have any corrections or additions? There's one spacing difficulty on page three, but it's really not worth mentioning, I don't think. Six paragraphs down on page three, Mr. Emery. There's a space between Mr. and Emery, but other than that, I think they're fine. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
That they be accepted as corrected. Thank you very much. All in favor? Raise your right hand. Thank you. It's unanimous. Correspondence received since the last meeting, a letter from Paul Frinsco regarding the Town Center zoning amendment, a letter from the Town Manager regarding the Town Center zoning amendment, a letter from P. DeShays regarding the Sound Center project, a letter from M. Edgar regarding the Sound Town Center project, a letter from Mallory Heffenreffer regarding the Town Center project, a letter from M. Vetterline regarding the Town Center project, a letter from the Town Attorney regarding bisected lots, a memorandum from the Town Manager regarding the Town Center project, a letter from William Nemers regarding the Town Center project, a letter from Mr. and Mrs. Murray regarding the Town Center project, memorandum from the Code Enforcement Officer regarding the Town Center project, a letter from Ron Azzolino regarding his resignation from the Planning Board. I understand, although I've not spoken to Mr. Azzolino, that he is moving out of the area, and we're sorry to miss him. He's been a good addition to the Planning Board in the last year. And last but not least, zoning news for November of 1997. The next order of business is the application of Atlantic Cellular Antenna, an antenna site plan review, a request by Atlantic Cellular Telephone Corporation to add antennas to an existing tower located at 351 Spurwink Avenue. The applicant would please proceed to describe the changes that have been made since the last meeting, then we'll proceed to the public hearing, which has been scheduled.
Madam Chair, I'm going to defer. My name is Barry Hobbins. I'm the attorney for Atlantic Cellular Telephone Corp. That does business here in the marketplace, Cellular One. I'm going to defer right now to Charles Brown, the Vice President of Field Services of Sebago Technics, who has done the field work and will explain the revisions since the last meeting, which was held on November 18th before this board.
Thank you, Jerry. Madam Chairman, members of the board, my name is Charles Brown. I'm with Sebago Technics. We've made just a few minor changes to the site plan. Basically, they were driven by the comments from the town engineer. Just step over here and make note of them. We have established a finished floor elevation for the new building, which is proposed at 114.4. We've added a site benchmark, which is the existing floor of the main cellular building at elevation 114.0. We've also added a guardrail on the most southerly parking space, which is proposed, and developed a erosion control and sediment plan as requested by the town engineer. I have copies of those if the board would like them.
They were not included in the packet, so.
No, they've been generated since we've received the information from the town engineer, his last comments. Those are basically the modifications to the plan. Other than that, I'd be glad to run through what the original application was, if anybody would like.
I probably would be helpful for you to summarize the initial application. Certainly. Because we're proceeding to a public hearing tonight.
The application is to, in two phases. The first phase would be to take the existing antennas off the second mounting bracket on the existing tower and replace the antennas that are up there with new antennas and cables. Initially, those cables would be hitched to the existing radios in the main cellular building and operated from that facility. At some point in time, when Cellular One receives notification to evacuate the main cellular building, then we would put the foundation and place the new building in its location on the open side of the existing tower. In order to place that building there, we would relocate the existing propane fuel tank to the outside, on the outside of the existing circular driveway, fence that in, and provide a hookup for the generator to the main wireless facility. Be very similar to the existing tank, which is there for the main cellular building. At the time that we construct the foundation and place the new building for Cellular One, which is Atlantic Cellular, we would build two service parking areas for the vehicles, which are there periodically to service the radios and the functioning of the radio. That's basically the modifications to the site plan, really very simple.
Thank you, sir. Do any board members have any questions of Mr. Smith? Mr. Emery.
One question. Are there any warning lights or hazard lights on the tower now?
My name is James Wilson. I'm the senior systems engineer for Vanguard Cellular. At this time, there are no lights or painting on the tower. The modifications that we plan to make will make no change in height, so that should not change.
There'll be no change in the lighting then?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Emery, if I recall, you asked that question when this application or this applicant was before us the last time and we explored lighting, so it's helpful to have you do that again. Any further questions from board members? Okay, then without further ado, I will proceed to open the public hearing. If anyone who is in the audience tonight wishes to speak concerning this project, please be our guests and proceed to the podium at this point. We'd like to hear from you if you have any concerns. Well, not seeing a stampede of people rushing to the podium, I think this is going to be one of the shorter public hearings that we've had this year. So without further ado, unless I see anybody, but I don't, the public hearing is closed. Proceed to, as you know, the board has the option to approve or approve with conditions or deny the application this evening. So if any board members are have any concerns, please raise them at this time. Mr. Parker.
I'll make a motion. Motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Atlantic Cellular Telephone Company is requesting approval to install new antennas in a new utility building at the foot of an existing tower located at 351 Spurwink Avenue. Number two. The application was deemed complete on November 18, 1997, and a public hearing was held on December 16, 1997. Number three, the steeply sloped character of the site warrants the preparation of an erosion control plan and submission of the first floor elevation, which has been done. So let me delete number three. Number three. The application substantially complies with Section 19-9-5 site plan regulations and Section 19-8-3 resource protection performance standards. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Atlantic Cellular Telephone Company for a site plan review and an RP3 permit to install antennas in a building at the foot of existing tower located at 351 Spurwink Avenue be approved subject to the following conditions. Number one, okay, the plan, excuse me for interrupting here, the plans have been revised to reflect those two changes, correct?
But they haven't been submitted to us. The applicant has brought them to us this evening.
But they've been submitted to you?
Nope.
No, he still has them. So
okay.
I would suggest
I will
that
leave
we,
it in then. Okay.
If we revise the motion as stated, then they can be presumably promptly reviewed thereafter. But I don't think anybody's really looked at them at this point.
Okay. Then number one, that the plans be revised to address the issues raised by the town engineer in his letter dated 11/10/97 and summarized in letter dated 12/9/97. And two, that the plans be revised and approved by the town planner prior to any alteration of the site and/or issuance of a building permit.
Do I hear a second to the motion?
Second.
Mr. Emery? Mr. Parkhurst, I have a question for you. Would you accept an amendment to the findings of fact that would include number three as stated in our draft so that, and then the number, the paragraph initially characterized as three would then be renumbered four just as it is in the draft so that we could proceed accordingly?
Oh, that would be fine.
I would make that then as a motion to amend the previous motion. Do I have a second for that motion? Is that acceptable to you,
Mr. Emery? Yes,
fine. Any discussion? Seeing no questions, all in favor of the motion as amended, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much, Mr. Hobbins and the applicant. The next order of business is the Town Center Medical Building. Change of use site plans. A request by the Cape Elizabeth Land Company for site plan review of a proposed medical office apartment building. And change of use of the existing building to a village retail shop use, both located at 330 Ocean House Road. Reviewed for site plan completeness. I understand that this evening the Cape Elizabeth Land Company is requesting site plan review of the medical office building, but the application for the former Fish and Farm Market building will not be pursued by the applicant this evening. Ms. Gilbert, would you like to describe the, or Mr. Juris, describe the changes that have been made to the plan since the November meeting so we can get started?
Well, I was just coming up to introduce everyone again and to say
Very
hello
well.
To everyone and happy holidays. Basically, I am Charles Juris, representing Cape Elizabeth Land Company. With me tonight are Sebago Technics' Nancy Gilbert. She's going to be talking about the engineering changes that were done to the property. And Bill Nemers, who's the architect, will also be discussing the renderings and changes to the look of the building and how we have changed it since our last meeting a month ago. I will, at this point, turn it over to Nancy and let her start the process of explaining to you how we've changed things.
Thank you.
Thank you, Charlie. As Charlie mentioned, my name is Nancy Gilbert. I'm with Sebago Technics. And I presented the plans to you folks at the last meeting. And as a result of the discussions that we had, we went back and rethought some things on the site and have prepared for you the plans that you see before you tonight. What I wanted to do was to show you folks on the rendering over here. Basically, one of the focal points of interest at the last meeting was the wetland area that is existing in this location here. As one of the members of the community had pointed out, the ordinance precludes placement of parking structures within an RP2 wetland. So we went back and redesigned the site in order to eliminate the impact to that RP2 wetland. What we've done is on the older plan, if you remember, we had a drive-through and a drop-off area adjacent to the building. What we've done is eliminated that area and made it simply a pedestrian area in that location. That allowed us to keep that closer to the building itself and allowed us to maintain the existing wetland area intact. What we've done is incorporated that wetland into the design feature and the landscape feature within the site. We've kept the wetland as it is. There's no fill proposed within the wetland itself. What we're proposing to do is, adjacent to the wetland in this area here, is to excavate an area that would be used for a permanent pool as part of the stormwater management area. During larger storm events, what will happen is the flows from the site will enter into this area and gradually back up into this area and then slowly release out and come out to a level spreader in this area here and then flow on to the rest of the site. We've incorporated the wetland and its natural flood flow alteration regime within the overall plan. At this rendering that you see here is a rendering of the landscaping plan, and what we've done is tried to incorporate plant materials that will accent and be sort of a fringe type plant material between what's existing within the wetland area itself, which is a mix of kind of scrub type growth, and the more ornamental or formalized plantings within the parking area itself, so that we've provided a buffer area in here. In addition, what we've done is we went back out to the site and we did some additional tree surveys on the site and identified some more specimen trees that we'd like to save as part of the overall development of the project. You can see that there are three trees within this area here that are outside of the wetland, but will be maintained as part of that overall plan. In addition, there are two trees here, a series of trees in this large sort of odd-shaped island in the center of the parking area, as well as some additional trees that are on the edges of the parking area. The layout itself was originally, if you recall from the prior plan, more linear, more rectangular, and what we've done is incorporated some curves in here to sort of work with the natural landscape and try to preserve some more of the trees that are in the middle of the development area. In addition, we're saving trees in this area here, as well as the trees that we originally intended to preserve along the frontage of the property. We do still have 100 parking spaces proposed on the site. We would like to work with the planning board to see if there are some options for perhaps shared parking or something along those lines. It's our understanding that the board doesn't have the latitude to simply reduce the number of parking spaces if there needs to be some sort of an alternative provision for that. So the plan does show 100 parking spaces, but we are willing to explore what alternatives might be available to perhaps either phase that parking or to share it in some way to reduce the total number of spaces on the site. As I mentioned, this wetland area has sort of become a focal point of the plan and the landscape in this area here, and then the existing plantings or the existing trees within the island here are also a key feature that we want to retain. If you look on the planting plan, you'll see that there's quite a bit of landscaping proposed in that island area, and what we tried to do was to incorporate plant materials that would be varying in height, varying color. There's rhododendrons in that planter area. There's different flowering and colorful trees so that you get sort of a seasonal variety of color throughout the year to accent the existing trees that we're proposing to preserve. We presented the plan to you folks at the last meeting. As I said, this was one of the issues was avoidance of the wetland area, and we feel that we've successfully done that. We, as I mentioned, are not proposing to fill within that existing wetland and be preserving the vegetation as it stands in that area. There were some other comments that were made by Steve Harding of Ost Associates regarding his review of the application materials that were submitted. The package that was submitted in response to your comments that night also included responses to Mr. Harding's comments. We have received a follow-up letter from Mr. Harding. Most of the issues, I think, are pretty well resolved. one of the comments that he had was pertaining to stormwater management, and I have had a meeting with him, and we have talked about some different alternatives for looking at various options within the site. Basically, what we're proposing to do is to collect the runoff that occurs within this development area, as well as the runoff which is right now discharged directly within this site from the town hall property. We're combining that into our storm drainage system and incorporating controls of that in this stormwater management area. The structure that controls this stormwater management area, for the most part, is controlled by a 1-inch orifice, basically the size of a garden hose. And only during the 25-year storm event do we get a somewhat larger flow coming over. There's a secondary weir that comes in there. We've analyzed the site based on the pre versus the post-development peak runoff rates leaving the site. And in the 2010 and 25-year storms, the peak rates of runoff are either equal or less than the pre-development rates. One thing that Mr. Harding and I talked about was looking at an alternative to evaluate the stormwater and seeing if there's an existing wetland that is over here in this area of the site, and seeing how that wetland functions in the overall picture. And so we took a little bit different tack in evaluating the model to see whether that wetland acted almost as a pond, and when actually would that wetland fill and begin to overflow. And what we found in the evaluation is that because we are detaining in this area here, that the actual volume of water that's coming into that ponded area, if you will, or that wetland that serves as a temporary storage area, is actually very slightly reduced in the post-development, and it's because we are detaining back in this area here. So we are still working with OST Associates and do plan to continue to work with OST Associates. I understand that there was a letter submitted to you folks from R.G. Gerber, or Gerber Jake Swipford, I guess it is now, regarding their commentary on stormwater runoff, and we certainly would be willing to sit down with, as the letter suggested, Maureen and Mr. Harding, to go over everything and evaluate that letter in the context of the overall plan. We certainly want to make sure that everything is done in accordance with the applicable criteria for not only the local review, but this project will require a DEP stormwater permit. It's a new law that took effect in 1997. And with respect to that, it trips the threshold for stormwater review for water quantity. And the reason for that is that the total of building and impervious area is just over an acre. And there is a review process for that. It's an individual permit process. We've had conversations with Linda Kokemuller at the DEP, and we'll be arranging a pre-application conference to go over the plan materials. As I mentioned, the stormwater law for this project requires a quantity review. The standards that review holds are that the peak rate of runoff is not increased as it leaves the site for the 2010 and 25-year storm, very similar to what the local criteria is. So we don't expect that the state review process will have an effect on our overall design of the project because it's the same criteria. And so, as I mentioned, we will be pursuing that with the DEP. I understand that is something that you folks will want to be discussing tonight in your evaluation. Bill Nemers is here tonight, and he is going to be talking to you folks about the building and the changes that have occurred in the building since you folks last saw it. Before I turn it over to Bill, there is one other thing I did want to mention, and that is with regard to lighting. We have been working with a lighting consultant. The lighting fixtures, there are catalog cuts that were submitted as part of the package to you folks that showed that the lighting fixtures they have a solid dome cover, so they're focused on lighting downward. The pole mounting heights are on some of the fixtures are 8 to 9 feet. On the higher ones, they're about 12 feet. And so what we've done is we've tried to keep low lighting and shielded the decorative fixtures to keep it a nice landscape. We've been working with a lighting consultant to develop and adjust the lighting pole locations to make sure that the lighting intensities are in accordance with the ordinance criteria for that, and we're, as I said, working with a lighting consultant on that. We are developing that plan. Unfortunately, I don't have that. Due to the marvel of electronics, the computer program that was sent email could not be opened today. So we are still trying to coordinate with them to get that information interface so that we would have that to present to you folks to show you that we are complying with the ordinance criteria for that. And I'm going to turn to Bill.
Thank you very much, Ms. Gilbert. Mr. Nemers.
Good evening. My name is Bill Nemers, the architect for the project. I want to briefly run you through what we have to show you tonight and point out differences between what we have here and what we showed you the last time. There are several generators of the differences. One of the comments from this board, comments from the public, we had meetings with the people in town. All these came as one set of points that made us relook at the elevations. We also had some internal reactions to what was going on that made us readjust our plans, and that had something that had
excuse me, Mr. Nemers, if you all are going to talk, would you be nice enough to scoot out the back? Thank you. Please continue.
Oh, I'm sorry. I will. One of the main problems with the building before is we looked at it from the point of view of both the committee here and people around town was that it looked too big. We had four stories of offices and then another story worth of residential on the top. We had included the residential because it was what we thought the zone would like to have is more residential in it, and it did say that in the zone. But it was just pushing it just a little bit too much, and so we took the residential out. We also were sensitive with the elevations at the back of the building, the new reworking of the site with respect to the drainage for the pond, as Nancy described earlier, raised the elevation along the back of the building such that we had to raise the entire thing in order to get good access to the back of the building. This, again, made some difference in the heights that we had to worry about. So for those two purposes, we took the residential units off the top of the building. That, with respect to those changes, means we were effectively lowering the visual aspect of the building by about 5 to 6 feet, if you measure it from the grade line to the eave line. Okay, that difference there changed. The building is sitting higher now than it was before because we'd raised the first floor level up, and so that the grade line itself is raised up a little bit, so that the effective look of the building is just a little bit smaller, but it's a little bit higher. You can see from the line here, we still, the top of the building will be maybe at the eave level of this building, or a little bit above. So it's sitting down quite low with respect to that. In removing the residential from the top floor, what we did was we pushed some of the top floor of offices up into the eave space of the building. And so the top floor of offices can now have cathedral-ish kind of ceilings, if you will, and get some really nice offices up in the top floor. But that's what you see here now, is these offices, these big windows up in here, would be into the top floor of the office space. So we'd in fact have 1, 2, 3 levels of office space that you can see from the highway. On the back side of the building from the parking lot, you can see we have added another layer of office and retail space on the bottom here, so that there are actually four levels in looking at it from the back of the building. This fits in quite nicely with the site because at the front of the site, at the street level, out in front here, the elevation is like 98.98, and back in the back of the building, it's about 190. So that's about a foot, about an 8 foot difference, which is about what one floor is. So we're pretty close to fitting it in there. We wanted to fit it in there like that so that we could save more trees without disturbing too much of the ground area around it. We can keep the ground pretty much where it was at the beginning of this operation. And if we keep it where it is at the beginning, then we can don't have to worry about undercutting trees or cutting tree roots and that sort of thing. And so I think we're able to save a goodly amount of the smaller trees as well as the larger ones around the building. The basic philosophy of the design of the building has changed little since the first time we brought it to you, other than the relationship of those 3 to 4 floor differences. The entrance is still on the side we talked about before, the towards the farm stand. This is the major entrance to the building. We have shown the same sort of details on the building that were there before, details that refer to the as the zone ordinance says it refer to, say, residential details in other buildings in the town. And so we have a little entry porch here that's similar to, not similar, but revokes the entry porch here and other entry porches on the residential buildings down the road. We have a collaborative building with wood trim, just like the other buildings in the, that we like to take a look at up and down things. And so I think this fits in pretty nicely with scale-wise with especially this building here and others in the area. So I think with that, I'll give that as an introduction to the project.
Thank you, Mr. Demmert.
Any questions you have? Thank you.
Okay. As the board knows, the first order of business this evening is to determine whether the application is complete. Do any board members have any questions or comments of the applicant? Mr. Carlson.
I have a question on 12B, the sanitary waste disposal system. We got a letter in the mail today which tells us that there'll be a total of 32 people in this building, if I'm correct. 8 medical staff, 6 clerical staff, and 8 doctors. At 20,000 square feet, that's 600 square feet per person. I wonder if there aren't going to be more people in the building. Can I have a clarification on that?
The letter that you're referring to is a letter that I prepared, and that was a letter that was sent to Steve Harding of Ost Associates. And Steve asked me to take a look at the projected sewage flows leaving the facility based on an evaluation procedure that's in the Maine State Plumbing Code and has a very specific set of criteria for types of employees in a medical office or clinic type use. What we did was we took and based an evaluation on some tenant information that we had obtained based on what we had for a number of physicians and their interest in a certain square footage area, projected that if the that same type of use were used in the entire building to try to give a feel for if that were to go sort of on the other end of the spectrum with total office or total medical office use. The medical office use in the plumbing code has a very high number. It's 80 gallons per day per physician. It has a certain ratio for medical staff. It has a different ratio for clerical staff in a medical office, and it has a number for patients. What we tried to do was the original analysis that we had done for Ost Associates was based on an employee count within the building on a normal, sort of a generic employee space and sewage flow rate, which was one employee per 250 square feet of space and 15 gallons per day per employee, which is a normal type office use, office occupancy. That gave a flow rate of 1,200 gallons a day, which was our original number that we presented to OST Associates. The recent changes in the plumbing code have included a more specific type flow rate for a medical office type use, where you get such a high rate for a physician, where you get such a higher rate for a medical staff person. So what we tried to do was look at it and say, okay, if we've got a certain number of physicians who expect to have a certain number of staff who expect to see a certain number of patients a day, and we were to project that for the entire building being used by that type of a use, what sort of a flow rate would that generate? And I think it was over 2,600 gallons. So we're looking at someplace in that range, but it's very hard to know on a tenant mix. And yes, I understand exactly where you're coming from when you say, gee, that's kind of a low number for that size building. But you also have to look at that if we went with the higher number on a standard number of employees and that type of a waste flow, what would happen would be you'd actually get a lower sewage flow. So we feel that we're in the comfortable range. But that was why OST Associates asked us to take a look at that.
In other words, you foresee that there will be 32 people in that building, on staff, not including patients. And you say in the very beginning here, proposed medical, professional, business, office building.
That's correct.
Is the building a medical building?
The building is, as it's been described, as a medical office business building, in that medical office tenants can occupy the building, but that's not to say that if, for example, an engineer or an attorney or someone wanted to occupy space in that building, that they wouldn't be turned away. So what we tried to do was get a projected flow that would work within the range of two very different types of uses. The plumbing code previously was very straightforward and it just had one number for an office type use. Where it's been specified, what we were asked to do was say, okay, if it went to the other end of the spectrum, what would it be?
Okay, thank you.
Any questions, any other questions from any board members? Mr. Emery.
Yes. Just a couple. Again, in light of all the correspondence and the fact that I think we all know that this project is being very closely watched, just want to reinforce the whole issue of the town center district, and I think it would be very helpful to the board and perhaps to the public and any concerned abutters if you laid out in somewhat the way that Mr. Nemers just started his presentation, laid out the ways in which you feel this project meets the intent and purpose of the town center zone, both in its use as well as in its execution. And that might include something like doing photography in the area, if you haven't done it already, and displaying those photographs and putting them into some sort of a Xerox format that could be easily included in a package. I'm just thinking that the more information you provide us that reinforces your philosophy about your project and how it meets the town center zone criteria, I think would be helpful. In terms of the issue of completeness, I have a couple of things that I really think the project is lacking, although it started to discuss early on the issue of, I remember historically you came in with a several lot subdivision essentially and the board asked you not to do that but to go back and do a master plan of the overall lot. And then you went through some issues with respect to contract zoning, which the council voted down. And since then, we've now been asked to look at a single individual lot on a 9-acre parcel. And a lot of the comments I'm reading and perhaps concerns that have been raised in the article is how does this fit in into the overall context. So from the board standpoint and dealing with the issues of the abutters and the general public as well, without designing a solution where every building has to be in every location of the site. I think it would be helpful for the board to see, as well as for the applicant, to understand how this driveway is going to affect future use, not only of your site and future development potential of the site, but also how it's going to affect circulation on Route 77. For example, if you either intend to branch off this driveway into future development or, to the contrary, would want to go further down south on the lot and have a separate driveway for another similar project. And I'd be interested to see conceptually how you see one part of the site working with the rest of the site and eventually, therefore, with the adjacent existing uses, the abutters, both behind you and across the street. Because I think the Town Center Committee, the zone, and all the deliberation that went before the council dealt with this parcel and with the Town Center in a very larger context, the effect that it has on the community and creating a community center. There's any number of scenarios that could play out here. This could be one building and nothing else would happen after that. Supposedly, you would develop this building, you could sell off the rest of the land, move away. But I think it's really important to understand from a traffic circulation, pedestrian circulation in context with the Town Center Zone, with stormwater runoff, the impact of lighting and so forth, how this fits into the overall development. And the most simple look at that sometimes just says, what does the zoning allow us to do and sort of what is the, with the lot coverage allowed, how much of the site is left open, how much parking might be needed, and how much building could be developed in accordance with the Town Center Zone. And again, I'm not interested in a design solution for the entire lot. I'm looking more to sort of a master plan from a land use standpoint and to show how it meets with the Town Center Zone guidelines. There's been a couple of letters submitted and some issues raised with respect to stormwater and wetlands. I will suggest, and of course the rest of the board can do what it likes, but I would suggest that we have peer review on the wetland delineation. And I'm not sure how that's accomplished, whether the abutters have already done it, whether the town would retain somebody, and if the, well, however it works, if the peer reviewer sees that it's essentially correct, then I guess the town pays for it, and if it's off, then the abutter contributes, or maybe not, I don't know.
Would the town planner like to address that particular point?
In the past, there's a couple of ways we can do it, and it depends on how the planning board wants to handle it. One would be to have the town engineer go out on site and take responsibility for doing that and reporting back to you. Second way would be to hire a separate entity other than the town engineer to go out and delineate the wetland. In both those cases, in the past, the applicant has been required to pay for that, and I believe the ordinance clearly supports the applicant taking on those costs.
I suppose a third way to do it would be to have the third party contracted to not necessarily delineate them from scratch, but simply review what the delineation plan is of the applicant's wetlands consultants.
In both, I would think it would be, in most cases, the applicants, the people that the town hires usually get the information the town has. For example, the wetland off of Dyer Pond Road was a case where there was information submitted by the applicant and the town engineer went out there, plus you hired a soils expert as a third party.
That's right.
Who also
gave us
an
independent report. Thank you.
The other issues I suggest, and I think, Bill, you've begun to touch with them in your discussion of the building, but be sure to address the issues of the streetscape and any public amenities that you may either have or not have with the project. I think one of the issues in the Town Center Zone talked about the importance of the streetscape and what happens between the building and the right-of-way and whether there are benches included. I saw the sketch on the signage. A clarification on the issue of the building height. That was quite a presentation and discussion on that. Maybe I'm just foggy on this, but did you refer to the roof as a hipped roof in that calculation?
Yes.
And is that treated any differently than a gable roof in the ordinance? Because I think originally you may have had a hipped roof on the building, but essentially what I see now is a gable roof.
What the town code enforcement officer and I reviewed this, and the ordinance treats, it's a little fuzzy, but it treats the, in our estimation, treats hip and gable about the same. The only difference was that the ordinance refers to the highest hip or gable, the center point being from to the highest hip or gable. In our case here, that it's essentially a hip-roofed building with large dormers, gabled dormers on it. And so the larger dormers, the higher dormers are the same dimension as the gable, as the hip. So it should, for instance, the this is basically a hip roof back here with dormers that come off of the ends to give some light into the upper office. But it's this dimension here that is the roof that take the midpoint of. And I think it's about the same on all those elevations. And I think that when I left the meeting with the code enforcement officer, we were in agreement as to what it said.
I guess I can see what you're saying is that in the parking lot elevation, the elevation to me, it looks like there's a ridge going the length of the building, and then there's gabled ends coming out to create full height dormers, for lack of any other term. But you're saying that someplace there's a, I guess I'm missing the hip, put it that way. I clearly see the hip over on the town hall building, but
yeah,
I don't see it. But just regardless of whether it's a hip or a gable end, the height measurement is taken to the midpoint between.
Yes, that, just for
not to the top of the ridge of the gable, correct, but to the midpoint.
And the height elevation is taken from the midpoint of the roof here to a point which is the average existing grade elevation around the building, and that elevation is actually down here someplace.
Okay.
Below, 3 or 4 feet below the ground line.
I don't want to get into design review or any issues like that, but just from a standpoint of completeness, and I think it drastically affects the building location, is the proximity of the building to the town hall property line. And I just noticed on your utility plan, for example, there's an electrical connection coming in there. This building would appear to have a fairly substantial, there could be quite an electrical connection, quite a transformer. So in running those lines, typically if you have natural gas, it'll have to be encased in concrete or put in conduit. As a completeness issue, I guess I would ask to confirm that indeed there's enough room between the property line and the building line to construct the building the way you intend to construct it and still leave vegetation as indicated in the building elevations. Will there be surgical suites in addition to medical offices as part of the building? Do you anticipate that?
Tenanting at this time is very wide open. I mean, we have not had specific discussions with anyone that would, we never even broached that subject. It was, are you interested in generally? Yes, we are, and this is what we roughly have, and this is what we're interested in. But we never got into surgical suites and that's why I think Mr. Carlson's question about tenanting and how many people are going to be in the building, it's one of these things you try to come up with some kind of a balance, which is basically unknown at this point. We just don't know that for a fact. So to answer your question, we never had the conversation with anyone about that.
Uh, I guess that hits on the major questions that I had.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Any other questions from anybody regarding completeness? Mr. Carlson?
Yes, 2 years ago, we talked about a master plan when we first met. And I just have a concern. I know it's not part of the check-off list, but when we worked with previous developers, be it commercial, for instance, Dominica's Crossing, which is phase 2, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and they're certainly not going to build all four phases at one time, but we were able to secure a very good idea of where the roads are going to be, where the houses were going to be located, driveways, and a very cooperative effort between the board and the developer, the applicant. I'm concerned here, we've got a building, and we could have 200 more parking places. I mean, that's being observed. We don't share places. But there's room for two more buildings. We have a massive backyard. And I somewhat sense that the applicant is maximizing what he can get out of the piece of property. This idea about the height of the roof, I suspect it's probably 34 feet 6 inches. I don't think that's, at least it's not my observation, that we should do. We're trying to do something with the comprehensive plan called for, the master plan called Town Center Plan. And here we are, and it was just stated, we don't know what we're going to be having there. We don't know if we're going to have suites. We don't know really how many doctors might be. There's all kinds of rumors flying around, but there's nothing definitive. And in the past, my 3 years, 4 years on the board, we've gotten some idea of where we're going. And if you're marketing a piece of property, I would think you would have a plan of where you're going. In addition to that, if you're going to build a house for the least expensive square footage, you go straight up. You don't build a ranch. And you get maximized. And I'm concerned about maximizing this site to the extent where we're going to go for the most for the least. And the town people work so hard for the town center plan and the comprehensive plan. I don't think they're going to be very pleased with that. I think there has to be a cooperative effort. We're here to kind of work with you, not for you, not against you, but with you. And we've done that with previous developers with much success. And I hope we can do that here. But let's not, how far can we go before we're over the edge? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carlson. Mr. Parkhurst.
I'm not a designer, architect, or whatever, but it's my understanding that medical buildings are very, very highly designed for the intended end users. And it seems to me we have a sort of a sketchy building here that has been designed from the outside, but not really thought has been put on the inside because you don't have a tenant yet. So it seems to me that the if the medical use doesn't fly, then, gee, would it be open to a gym or something like that if there wasn't the need for the medical space? And it seems to me that a gym or a workout health club or something like that would use far more gallonage than a medical office building would. And it just seems to me without a specific group of tenants or tenant or something in mind that this is so highly speculative that it doesn't make much sense to me. The only other thing I think I have to say is just something that Tom had said earlier. This project is being very carefully watched because this is going to set the tone for the rest of what remains of vacant land in the town center of Cape Elizabeth. And I think everyone is going to be very, very careful all the way through that this is done properly and that everything is done carefully and there are no mistakes made along the way. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. Any other comments or questions from board members? Mr. Emery.
thinking back on my late evening review of this the other evening, the applicant noted that a traffic study is not required by per the ordinance, and I believe you, did you not retain Jack Murphy to provide comment?
Yeah, I didn't say it wasn't required. Steve Harding said that it didn't meet the criteria.
Yeah. Okay.
We, as part of our original application to you folks, had asked Jack Murphy to come out, take a look at the site, look at what we were proposing, and write to you folks a letter regarding his findings on the site, which was filed to you folks. Based on those findings and Steve's comment that the trip generation, et cetera, affiliated with the building wouldn't require further traffic study, it was our understanding that issue had been addressed.
I don't have that letter in front of me. Do you happen to recall the gist of what I'm getting at is whether or not, regardless of the number of trips coming off the site, was there an issue in terms of the intersection with Jordan Way and the intersection at the Pond Cove Shopping Center?
I don't have, off the top of my head, the exact numbers that Jack had in his letter, too. I think Maureen's looking for it right now. Do you want to read?
This is from Steve Harding's letter of December 9 this year, page 2 under traffic. The applicant's consultant has reported.
Excuse me, Mr. Emery, it's attached to this. Yeah.
Yes, right. I have it. Right. I just happened to turn right to it.
Go ahead. Sorry.
Has reported that this project will generate approximately 80 trips during the peak hour, which is below the threshold required for traffic study by town ordinance. Just so you know, that the new site plan standards specify the number of traffic you need to, the amount of traffic you need to generate before you have to go to the expense of a traffic study, and that's 100 trips per peak hour, and at 80, this is below that threshold. Further, according to Steve, further, there appears to be adequate site distance available in both directions from the proposed drive location. Then he talks about the width of the driveway and whether or not you may want to provide an initial lane. And then he mentions pedestrian traffic and the proposed sidewalk, and then he suggests a stop sign. So that's it in terms of traffic circulation.
Thank you.
Anything further, Mr.
Chairman? No, that's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Ms. Gilbert, if I could just ask you to run down briefly the summary of completeness checklist and make sure that we understand what the applicant's position is on each of the items. I would just appreciate it for my own purposes and the review for the record. Do you have the memo dated December the 16th? Sorry, I don't mean to press you. I know this is a fair amount of paper. I take it there's absolutely no difficulty with number 11, which is the addition of a painted crosswalk?
Yes.
Okay. And the position of the applicant on 12A is?
The location design of existing and proposed stormwater systems, as I mentioned, we are still coordinating with Steve Harding of Ost Associates. Tonight we did receive the letter from Gerber Jakes Whitford, and we're certainly willing to cooperate on anything that we need
okay,
to do
so,
with that.
So you intend to?
Yes.
To do that.
Yeah.
Number 12B?
12B, the location design of sanitary waste disposal systems. I believe that the reason that that is only identified as partial is actually two parts. One is the letter that you folks saw tonight regarding the range of flows, which Steve had asked for, which I think addresses that issue. The second is that the plan that we submitted shows the locations of the, there's two sewer manholes out in front of the site on Route 77. Steve had asked us to either tie our survey datum into the town's datum so that the information on the town plans could be used to verify the inverts or actually go out and physically identify them. We went to the town, we got the plans from the Public Works Department, and unfortunately, not only are they on a different datum, but they also don't have the rim elevation, so we couldn't tie the two together. So my crew was out here today, I don't know if you saw them out in the middle of the street, but they were out there getting the invert information on those two manholes. So that survey information has been obtained. What Steve asked us to do was to put that information on the plan. In addition to that, we do have a sort of an adjustment factor that ties our site datum into the MDOT datum, which was used when the DOT did work on Route 77, and that's about, I think it's a 2.6-foot adjustment factor in that, I do this right in my head here, MDOT plus 2.6 equals the site elevation. So, and we will be putting that information on the plans and providing that in all detail for you.
Very well. Number 13.
The landscaping and buffering plan, I think, if I recall, that is a comment that Maureen had asked you folks to consider, the buffering that was on the site and how that fit into the overall context of the site. I'm not really sure if that's been discussed at any length to know what you folks would want us to do on that. And then I guess the 14 was lighting location, wattage, and foot candle radius, and we talked about that in that we are continuing to coordinate with the lighting consultant to get that intensity plot.
And number 16, do you intend to submit any other information about previous projects to demonstrate financial capability?
I'll let Charlie talk to that one.
Okay. Mr. Juris.
We did submit a bill numbers. I sent another letter over today, which I thought it had been submitted once before, but we had gotten a question whether or not anyone had it. So Mr. Nemers sent over another letter today that basically outlined business backgrounds of the individuals are extensive. Without going into a detailed list of everything that I've worked on in 10, 15 years of real estate, the last project that I just finished was the Wyndham Shopping Plaza, a $2 million renovation, all new tenants. I'm very sensitive to tenant needs, and that was what that building shows, that we brought in a whole series of new tenants and designed the building to meet their needs specifically so that they've been very successful. We'll continue to do that here as well. And we will take a lot of time to make sure the right tenant mix is found. We're not looking to just maximize the site, or we're looking to do something that's going to be quality and also where the tenants are going to be successful. We do not have a handle on exactly who the tenants are. I think it would be premature to try to sign people to a building or make a commitment to a building that has not been approved. I think it would be somewhat arrogant to come forward and say, well, sign up for this building. We don't even know if we have a building. We don't know what it's going to look like. We still have a long process to go here with you people, and we're wide open to that. As far as the background, I think we have answered that with that letter.
Thank you. If no board member has any further comments, I guess my only concerns at this point are two on the completeness issues. One, in addition to what's been said already, I should say that I really would like to have as much attention paid as possible to the buffer line, which is item 13. And if people on the board have any further discussions on that issue, I would be more than happy to hear them. The other issue that I'd like to address, with all due respect both to the applicant and to the town manager, is the item number 16. The board has on its checklist a requirement that the technical and financial capability of the applicant be assured. And what we are asked to consider with respect to that is a letter from the town manager dated December the 3rd, which says that in conformance with section 19-9-4C16 of the zoning ordinance, I have explored with due diligence the Cape Elizabeth Land Company's financial capabilities to complete the proposed medical and office building on the lot to the immediate south of the Cape Elizabeth Town Hall. As in nearly all of these reviews, the corporation or partnership making the application does not yet have substantial assets of its own. I have instead reviewed the financial capability of the principal partners and or officers of the company. I recommend to the planning board that you find that the applicant has the financial capability to complete the project as proposed in a timely manner. I don't for one moment purport to try to second guess the town manager. All I would say is that it's one thing to have the principals of a company have a great deal of financial capability. It's another thing to have the company itself have commitments from the individuals involved and also from lenders to support a project of this magnitude. And I, for one, would like to ask the town manager to review and frankly insist on subscription agreements or something in writing so that the applicant can draw on its financing either from its owners or from lenders or whoever the applicant intends to draw on for financing, so that we don't have a situation where we have owners who have who are individuals who have assets in and of themselves, but quote unquote prefer not to allocate assets to this particular venture. Other than that, I don't think I have any further comments on the completeness application. Does any board member have any further comments to address to that issue? Mr. Parkhurst.
The 25-foot buffer at the back of the site, without unfolding the plans and banging the microphone, does it run the whole length of the property, or is it just this one section?
Oh, it's entirely.
Okay.
Now, are we talking about the buffer on the back or on the side with where the town hall?
Now,
it's on the side.
Excuse me?
It runs along the back and the southern side.
Okay, but he's just asking about the one.
One in the back.
Parallel to Route 77, right. But removed.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Now, that's intended as a buffer, but I believe it's intended to be given to the Conservation Commission or something along those lines as part of the green belt. Now, that to me connotes a pathway. And a pathway in a buffer zone, I don't know if we've done that before or not, but it seems to me that sort of defeats the purpose of a buffer zone by cutting a path through it.
We did not. We intend to submit a letter to the town offering that that piece of property with no conditions, no covenants on it. Basically, the town is capable of doing what it wants. We are offering it as a buffer. If the town wants to construct a path in it, that is something that we can discuss. But at that, we are offering it as a buffer, and it was requested by a variety of different people, citizens, and I believe one of the letters came forth in the last meeting also suggested a buffer be established, and that is the intent of that 25-foot strip.
Thank you.
Any further comments? Do I hear Mr. Carlson?
Yes, back to the master plan again. I'd like to ask the town planner, has there been other cases earlier where the master plan or a master plan was a requirement in the completion? I seem to recall something where that can work that way. And am I wrong in that assumption?
I can't think of a project prior 1990 where the board up past since 1990 where the board had a master plan. If the board would like to require that a master plan be part of the completeness, since this question's already been asked, I've already done my research. In the zoning ordinance, starting on page 1, the purpose of the zoning ordinance reads that this ordinance is intended to carry out and be consistent with the town's comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan and its component documents, which include the town center plan, in this sentence, in my opinion, require that whenever you approve anything under the zoning ordinance, it has to also be consistent with the comprehensive plan. If the board felt that to find that this project is consistent with the comprehensive plan, that a master plan would need to be provided, my expectation would be that any master plan would have to have some kind of proposed location for buildings or structures or roads or driveways. And under the site plan requirements, item 6 says that you do have to show the proposed location and dimensions of proposed buildings and structures, roads, driveways, parking areas, and other improvements. So if the board feels that the only way they could find that this is consistent with the master plan, with the comprehensive plan, is to get a master plan, I believe that you could ask for that, and further that under item 6, it could be an item for completeness.
Thank you.
Any further discussion on that or any other issue regarding completeness? Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion. Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Cape Elizabeth Land Company, LLC, for site plan review, construct a 20,000-square-foot medical office building located at 330 Ocean House Road, be deemed incomplete.
Is there a second? Mr. Emery?
Second. Just point of clarification, do we typically, in determining lack of completeness, also list the items to be included to make it complete?
I would propose to take a vote on the motion first to find out whether indeed we have a majority, and then if so, I think we only certainly owe the applicant that so that the applicant knows what is still missing. I'd like to clarify, so it's been moved and seconded that the application be deemed incomplete. I'd like to clarify the name of the applicant. Is it really Cape Elizabeth Land Company, L period, C period?
LLC.
Thank you. Will you accept the amendment to motion to accurately reflect the name as Cape Elizabeth Land Company, LLC? And Tom, I take it you will too. Mm-hmm. Any further discussion on the existing motion? All in favor of the motion as stated, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Then I think we need to proceed to a discussion of what we think is missing in order to allow the application to be deemed complete. Any brave soul want to start? Mr. Emery.
Well, the things I recall having been discussed, one was the peer review on wetlands. Mm-hmm. And I'll defer to the planner's checklist on the technical items that relate back to the engineer's report. The other one was a master plan. And perhaps included with the master plan or as a separate item, depending upon how clear we want to make this, is the issue of presenting information that demonstrates how this project meets the intent and purpose of the town center zone.
And when you say master plan, Mr. Emery, you're saying that is a term that applies to the entire 9-acre site?
That's correct. And I think it should be clear for the board. I think the purpose of that is so that the applicant, the board, and the public can understand what, as a possible future scenario, this in the carrying capacity of the site might be and how the first phase is going to impact that future capability and how the applicant envisions traffic working based on the current plan. Traffic circulation, stormwater.
Anybody else?
Oh, I'm sorry, another. Oh,
keep going.
Well, I noticed that there was a some discussion in a letter received. I believe we received it today regarding the 25-foot buffer and the actual purpose of that. And Mr. Parkhurst had expressed concern about a possible pathway going through that. I think the applicant made it clear that what the town may elect to do with the buffer is up to the town. But I've also read something that indicates that there may be more to the issue of granting that buffer to the town. If it would involve a change of use or anything that would appreciably affect the application, I think the applicant should be straightforward with that. Now, it would be my understanding that that should not take place, and however that would have to be deeded would be done so without affecting the design standards for the Town Center District. To the extent possible, and I understand in today's real estate market that, you know, it's not 1986 and there aren't people driving up from Boston, New York, and wherever every weekend looking for medical office space or other office space. Perhaps they are with medical office space, but to the extent that the applicant can clarify concerns with respect to the sanitary waste, the flexibility of the layout of the building, I think that's something that certainly Mr. Nemers could help with. In residential uses, what we typically ask for is a schematic unit plan, just something that indicates, okay, here we have a 5,000 square foot footprint that, you know, has a standard column spacing of something or other, and, you know, whether you want to just copy it out of a planning magazine or you want to just do a sketch of this building. But I think Mr. Carlson expressed some question about whether or not this building would be flexible to the extent that the lack of tenants is understood at this date, and what effect that might have on the design of the building. Is the building flexible enough? Would it require radical change in the exterior window arrangement, the scale of the building, those sorts of things? The thing that I guess we didn't discuss, but under landscaping and buffering, I think it's very important and very helpful, certainly from a design standpoint, is if there are existing trees to be saved, particularly where you've identified individual specimen trees, to note the type of tree and the size of those trees, and then to double check with all of the utility design, grading plan to be sure that those trees will actually be saved, that there will not be disturbance within a reasonable distance of the trunk. Typically, it's the drip line. That's not always maintainable, but I know from personal experience it's not unusual while someone's drawing a plan that shows a tree to be saved, someone else is running a storm drain underneath it. So that's I think that's helpful for everyone that's involved, both the applicant, the public, and the planning board. I think that was the items I had, except for the ones that were on the planner's checklist and the engineer's comment. Oh, I'm sorry. I also mentioned the issue of traffic. If you would just resubmit Jack Murphy's letter with respect to the circulation patterns, I think the issue is really more the circulation than it is the number of cars. It's an unusual location. And it's understood from the applicant's comments that they will be providing additional lighting information. They will work with the town on the other issues.
Mr. Emery, I guess you mentioned in particular the utilities that would come in from the road, and I'd
like to... Oh, I'm sorry, yes. The electrical connection to the building, it's drawn on the north side of the building, and I just... Inevitably, those things end up being about four times as large as you think, and sometimes the meters end up hanging on a wall, and it's as disgruntling to the architect as it is to the abutters and everybody else when those things sort of utility company comes in at the last minute and says, oh, because of this and this and this, it's got to be twice as large. So if you indeed intend to have it come along the north side of the building, and there's only 15 feet of separation there, either provide information that indicates that the trees will remain as indicated on the plan, and there's room to do that.
I just have two concerns to add to that. One has to do with the height of the building. I really would like to see as thorough and clear a discussion of how those dimensions are measured, and because I know that that is something that just needs to be paid very careful attention to. I'd like the board to be able to understand that as clearly as possible. And the other is I'd like to see a supplement to the technical capability to make sure that the applicant has a budget which is appropriate for a project of the scale and that it has the financial facilities to draw on. Mr. Emery.
If I may just pick up on this, and this is a suggestion that the applicant can consider or dismiss, but it appears from the elevations of the building, and one who's trained in reading elevations, as Mr. Wilcox certainly is, there's a lot more going on with the building that provides interest to it than the elevations can convey because of all of the stepping of the building and the different dormers and things. I'm wondering if it wouldn't be helpful to the board, to the public, and to the applicant to do a very simple foam core type model. I'm not asking for, you know, a $5,000, you know, sales model. I'm just looking for a massing model where they typically just take something like a blueprint and run the elevation, then stick it to a piece of foam core, or just cut out openings in the foam core. But something that's just a study model, but would really help the board to see that these planes are stepping back and that what appears to be a fairly large mass and elevation is really isn't so because it's of the angular nature of the building.
Any further discussion from the board? Any questions from the applicant? Not at this point?
No.
Okay. Fair enough. It's been moved, seconded, and determined that the application is incomplete at this point, so we will undoubtedly see you again. Thank you for this evening. The next item on the agenda is the Cliff Walk Site Plan Amendment, a request by the Town of Cape Elizabeth for an amendment to the Cliff Walk Site Plan to allow signage under Section 19-9-6. Mr. McGovern.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Emery.
I have to recuse myself. I have a punch.
Ah, yes. You remind us that you had something to do with this project. Okay, we're down to 5 board members. That's still a quorum, so. Mr. McGovern, why don't you proceed, and I think we'll clear the back of the hall. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McKay. Very pleased to be here this evening to discuss signs on the Cliff Walk project at Fort Williams Park. The Planning Board may recall that you originally proposed this project back during the month of May. I happened to be in Australia during that period and read of your approval on the internet while I was down there at an article in the Press Herald. And I think within that article it mentioned that someone had fallen off the cliff that very evening, as well as the fact that the Planning Board didn't approve signs. So it was interesting while I was in Australia. I took the opportunity to, which was my original plan, to visit many parks and to look at signage, including in some World Heritage areas, a place called the Cape Otway Peninsula, the Daintree Rainforest, as well as along a spot called the Great Ocean Road. Very beautiful scenery, and all had very interesting signage. Very subliminally, I have very small displays up here, trying to indicate just how small the signs are that we are presenting and that they're to blend into the environment. Just to recall, the Cliff Walk extends from the circle just above the beach as you're heading towards Portland Headlight. It's known as the circle where the Civil Defense Bunker is located, back to the Portland Headlight parking lot. The signage that is proposed is shown to be on a boulder within the trail. One slightly in on the southerly end, one slightly in the northerly end. The exact locations are shown on the plan submitted to you. This particular boulder that's shown is very similar to one you see at the Spurwink Church, which is just off to the right of the church. You can recognize there how much it blends into the scenery and is in keeping with the character of that historic site. The signage itself would sort of be double-sided. On one side, it would recognize the primary contributor to the project. This project is being funded with the largest single cash donation the town has ever received for any project in the community. The side on the right shows the slopes of the trail, attributes. That is necessary because under the ADA requirements, the trail is not totally accessible to the handicapped. That is not required. However, when it isn't totally accessible, it is important that you impart information as to those portions that are safe to travel. The signs, as indicated, are planned for approximately 9 inches by 12 inches. I noticed the draft proposal you have before you, drafted by the town planner, indicates 18 by 24. That's perfectly acceptable. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Are there any? Mr. Wilcox.
Mr. McGovern, could you, I'm a little confused on what the dimensions are. Could you sort of point to the sign and,
yeah,
and explain what the height and the width is there?
Yes, this would be 9 by 12, 9 by 12.
And where
this shows it actually as two separate plaques. It's entirely possible that one plaque will list the contributors, one very close beside it will list the trail attributes, because it's possible that they may be made of varying material. As you notice on the color plan, it shows the plaque being made of bronze type material, whereas the signage is much more difficult to do in bronze.
So is it actually 18 wide by 12 high rather than 18 by 24?
It would be 9 plus 9, 18.
18 wide.
That would be 12.
12. So 18 by 24 is much larger than what you're,
yeah,
intending to do. Would that be fair?
True.
Okay. I have another question that might seem very technical, but I like the proposed method of having the sign be part of a rock. But having some degree of experience with what the ADA requires for signs inside buildings in terms of permanent directional signage, it very specifically has to be a certain height above the ground and include Braille so that people who have difficulty with vision are able to receive the information, which this one, I don't think this one would be able to do that. Is that different for the outdoors?
I'm not totally familiar with all the ADA requirements for the outdoors. I think there's probably a larger issue with all of our trails throughout Cape Elizabeth, all of our outdoor signage. I think you'll find that we don't have any of it in Braille. We do try to make some reports available in large print, but you know, other than the signage up here in the front of the building, for instance, in the building that is in Braille, we never have put any outside signage in Braille.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wilcox. Are there any other questions?
Yes, I did forget to mention one thing. You might wonder at whose behest I'm here. I do want to indicate that this was reviewed with both the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and with the Town Council. It first came to the Council in June. They asked for an opportunity themselves to specifically review the plans. They did do that following a review by the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. The Fort Williams Advisory Commission reviewed these plans and approved it on a 6-0 vote. The Town Council subsequently approved the recommendation of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, and my recollection is it was unanimous vote when they considered the signs.
I just have one question following up on Mr. Wilcox's comments, and that is the request then that we approve signage no larger than 18 inches by 12 inches to be located at each end of the walk?
If you gave me 2 more inches, I wouldn't mind.
I was going to say, just in case for construction purposes, so 20 inches by 14, no larger than 20 inches by 14 inches?
That'd be fine, ma'am.
Any further questions or comments from the board? Mr. Parkhurst.
The material that the trail information will be on, what will that be made out of? Excuse me.
I'm not exactly sure yet. We have a consultant working on this project, and I have not specifically addressed that question to him. Elsewhere in the fort, we've used a metal photo process that mounts easily on a plaque. One concern, we have two concerns. One is we want to have it vandal-proof, and second, we also have to have it very resistant to the elements. The metal photo process with the finish that's worked on it has generally worked very, very well. Signs made of other material have not worked out as well. So my intent, subject to our landscape architect telling me different, would be to use the metal photo process, just as shown here, with a very earth tone background. and, you know, try to have it blend in with the bronze portion of it as well, should the other portion of it end up going in bronze.
Any further questions or comments from the board?
One other question.
Yes, Mr. Parker.
If we approve this tonight, which it sounds like we probably will, do you feel comfortable there won't be a request for any more signage on this?
I feel comfortable that there will not be any request for additional signage for this trail. I wouldn't want to say carte blanche that there might not be other signs that would come up in Fort Williams Park from time to time.
Yes, Mr. Wilcott.
I'm just sort of trying to think ahead a little bit. If these signs are done in the metal photo finish or whatever it's called, would it be safe to assume that the other signs, if they are placed in Fort Williams Park, would be made of the same material?
Yes, that would be a safe assumption.
And they would be as vandal-proof and as discreet as these appear to be?
I will not guarantee vandal-proofism. The intent of the town would be to have all of the signs be very discreet. Unfortunately, some of the metal photo signs we've had there previously, I don't know if you've seen any of them, they're very attractive, pen and ink sketches of the different buildings, and those have tended to be attractive for folks to have in a location other than with where they were originally intended.
Okay, I'm all set.
Mr. Wilson.
The example here shows us the list of donors.
That's correct.
10 donors, all named anonymous. Is that meant to be sort of a graphic to show us where names would actually be written in, or are there in fact 10 additional anonymous donors who remain anonymous? My question is just, are you limiting the number of names which will be placed on this sign in its final installation?
At this point in time, there are 2 donors. One is Mr. and Mrs. Augustus Barber. The second is Barber Foods, Inc. Mr. Barber, as well as his daughter Julie, have indicated that they are interested in furthering this project in the future by perhaps adding some benches and other amenities for as people walk along, they can rest and feel comfortable and admire the view. It is the intent that those future contributions would be recognized on this plaque. As of now, no one has donated any funds to our knowledge, but that is to indicate that they would be recognized on a plaque, and they probably would not be anonymous.
Is it your point, Mr. Wilcox, that if there were more than one anonymous contribution, it could be lumped together with one anonymous?
Well,
signatory?
No, I was just wondering if that was just a graphic or not. And from the description of there being benches, also a lot of times on benches there's a little plaque on each bench. It depends on how the fundraising actually ends up going, and I couldn't tell whether this was a collection of the whole project or whether the individual items would then receive recognition.
There's a desire that's been expressed a number of times to not be a proliferation of signs all across Fort Williams Park. And by trying to recognize it all in one place, it's in trying to keeping with that intent.
One of the things you might look into, which is less expensive than bronze, is acid-etched stainless steel, but I don't know if, because you can take it down and then add more things to it. But I don't know if it would come in the toned down look, which I think is...
I appreciate that advice, and I will relate it to our consultant to look into that.
Any further questions or comments from board members? If not, do I hear a motion? Mr. Carlson.
Need a motion for completeness, I assume, first.
Correct.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for amendment to a previous site plan approval for the Cliff Walk to allow signage be deemed complete.
Okay, thank you. Is there a second to the motion? Mr. Parker seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor of that motion, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Might you have a second motion, Mr. Carlson?
Shall I continue? Findings of fact. 1. The Town of Cape Elizabeth is requesting an amendment to the site plan approval granted by the Planning Board on May 20th, 1997 to allow signage at each end of the trail. Two, the application was deemed complete on December 16, 1997. Three, the planning board wants to limit signage in order to preserve the natural rugged character of the cliff walk. Four, the amendment to the cliff walk site plan substantially complies with Section 19-9-5 site plan standards. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for amendment to a previous site plan approval for the cliff walk to allow signage be approved, subject to the following conditions. One, that the signage for the cliff walk be limited to sign area no larger than 14 inches high and 20 inches wide, located at each end of the cliff walk trail.
Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion on that motion? Alice, do you want us to wait while you're flipping?
No.
Okay. Any further discussion on this motion? If not, all in favor, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Congratulations, Mr. McGovern.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I'd like to thank you for that approval and also use this opportunity to thank you for your service to the Planning Board over the last, I believe it is, 9 years as both Chairman, as a member, as well as Mr. Carlson, both of whom I understand this is your last meeting, retiring from the board. And I think, you know, as I look at some of the discussion this evening, it's been typical of your performance in this, on this board. Looking at the big picture and really what a proposal is all about, I think Mr. Carlson's comments on an earlier issue, as well as your very insightful review of the application completeness on an early proposal, just shows how fortunate Cape Elizabeth is to have the talent that we do have on this board, and really have enjoyed working with you, especially when we get approvals, and wish to thank you as well as to wish you all happy holidays. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Govern. How thoughtful of you to have an item on the December calendar. I commend you for your timeliness. Thank you very much for those kind comments. Alice, did you get the no larger than it was?
14.
Mr. Carlson, you said no larger than 14 inches wide and 20 inches high.
High, that's correct.
Last but not least, the Bottomley private access waiver is the last item on the agenda.
No.
It's a request by Peter and Marlene Bottomley for a private access waiver to create two lots on lot U32-13 located at 268 Mitchell Road, considered under section 19-7-9B. Would the applicant like to proceed? Mr. Hare.
Yes. My name is Brad Hare. I'm here tonight representing the Bottomleys. Peter is here. In their desire to create two lots out of the 36 acres that they own. What I'd like to do tonight I could use the low tech approach. Oh, there's a camera. I'll have to get the pin and clip method down next time when I come.
I can't see the bottom quarter of that. Is there a way of moving it forward a little bit, or are you resting it against?
Yeah, it's kind of resting against.
Okay,
teetering.
I'll just do what I can do to. That's a little improvement.
A little
thank you.
Welcome. The Bottomleys own 36 acres. We were here showing you what our intentions were at the workshop. They would like to fight the houses up to the front part of their parcel, keep the remaining basically 30 acres intact as it is now for their own use. We had shown you a plan at the workshop that looked like this. And after five meetings, we all, code enforcement officer, myself, Rick Cheney, And Maureen, we basically thought we had it pretty well nailed down. I happened to spend one late night reading parts of the ordinance that really didn't pertain to this project and came across an interesting little rule in the zoning ordinance regarding bisected lots, which basically says that the bulk of, if you're putting a private road through a lot, the bulk side of the lot, being the left side, has to equal what's required in the zoning ordinance, 80,000 square feet. Well, it didn't take me very long to realize that I did not have 80,000 square feet on there. So, and due to the fact that part of the zoning ordinance cannot be waived, but a planning board left me back at square one. So Maureen was gracious enough tonight to allow us to come here, talk about our plans, and show you the new plan, which meets that ordinance. So if you bear with me, I'd like to go over the whole idea again with the new plan that basically gives us the same outcome. The private road, instead of following the existing driveway from this point, needs to be brought in on the other side of the RP2 zone, connected up to an existing tote road that goes across from here and connects up to the Bottomley's driveway. So basically what I've done is I've just moved the road over from here to here. This whole lot on this side now is over 80,000 square feet. This green area from here to here, it's not connected. This dot is just by scale large enough that this land bleeds all the way through into lot two. So we do not have a bisected lot. Both lots are over 80,000 square feet. We're still staying out of all the RP2 zones. We have created additional buffers along this RP2 zone, which is not required by the zoning ordinance, simply due to the fact that the Bottomleys are very fond of this land and they feel that an additional buffer here will help maintain this area as it does relate to the pond. The pond itself has received, we've established kind of a little protectorate 100-foot buffer here earlier on the plan due to the fact that we didn't have a driveway through it. We don't need to have a 100-foot buffer here because the RP1 zone would require the pond and its related wetlands to be an acre or more. We've measured this five different ways, and it always comes up 0.97 acres. you know, I mean, Tom and I have been in this business a long time, and we usually don't like to come up to planning boards and say it's 0.97 acres. It is 0.97 acres. However, it's so close, we're taking a good hard look at it. We're not really
just
doing...
Just in case it rains, Mr. Hare?
That's right, just in case somebody falls in the ditch and blocks it up for a while. You know, we're really not doing a real estate development here. I think we can get through the process, maintain the pond, look at it very hard as an area to protect, and like I said, establish some buffers where we really don't... We're not required to, but for aesthetic and habitat reasons, I think it's a doable thing and will benefit everybody. We have comments from Steve over at Oates Associates regarding the road. I, due to the hour, and I think we will get out of here at a pretty decent time, I will submit for next month going through those items and looking at them for the submittal. But other than that, we're just here to get the board's comments so that the next time we submit, maybe we can get caught up to where we should be.
Thank you for coming this evening. Do any board members have any comments or questions for the applicant? Mr. Carlson.
I see the building envelopes here. Is this sewer?
Yes. Both these lots are going to be private force main sewers that will connect up to the existing sewer system in Mitchell Road. Due to the elevation, there's a dip in the land that prevents us from gravity feeding. They're going to be hooked up to, each individual will have a grinder pump to basically move it along.
Is the Bottomley residence, is that on a septic system right now?
Yes, that is. And what we're going to do is stub that out to the property line here and give them the option either immediately or in the future hooking up the same way, just so that once the road's in, it should be in for a long time.
Thank you.
Any further questions or comments from board members?
And just if Brad could clarify, on the location map, everything that's shaded on the location map is part of the property, the 36 acres?
Yes.
And the access road is at that narrow tongue, sort of at the top of the location map?
Right, okay. This, the frontage down here can be applied to the Bottomleys. Maureen and I have talked about that a couple times. There's only 50-foot frontage here shown on the Bottomleys parcel, yet they actually have, you know, well over 170 here. So we're going to be looking at this for frontage due to the fact that I don't particularly want to do one of those 50-50-50, you know, stub it out 50 feet into the lot and, you know, get the frontage just by going and wrapping around the right-of-way just for really no apparent reason.
I guess my larger question is, we have, should look at the information, how many acres are going to be retained by the Bottomleys?
30. Two lots equal about 6 acres.
And in theory, in the future, they could come in through that bottom area or extend off? Yeah, I'm just curious as to, we're using sort of this public access waiver provision or public road provision, but is there greater development potential or future development potential coming in off Mitchell Road at the lower end of the property, the southerly end?
I really don't think so, Tom. I think that RP1 zone down there and those steep slopes and that 100-foot buffer in there, the Bottomleys have no desire to develop this parcel into a subdivision. This is really it. My own personal opinion, walking down there several times, there's no way that they would probably get that through this board. Nor should they.
It's a wetland.
Yes, it's basically a wetland, very obvious.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Mr. Emery. Any further questions or comments? Mr. Wilcox?
I have a question regarding the building envelope shown on lot one.
Mm-hmm.
It appears to be very similar to the originally shown building envelope. Is that because that's the best place to
it is.
Put a structure, not respective of the actual boundary of the parcel?
Correct. Peter and Marlene have been on this land for over 5 years, and basically how they approached it with me was, we have two places that we think houses could be placed on this parcel that maintain the rural character, that are kind of tucked. This one's tucked in so you don't see it from Mitchell Road. This one can't be seen from anywhere. And you know, how do we get a road to fit those two building sites? So that's how we basically started out with this. And our intention was not to enlarge the building window on lot one so that someone could get in there and build a very large house or cut down a lot of trees. Peter and Marlene, his intention is to build that house themselves so they can control the architectural design of that. So we've kind of stuck that building window there because it's the right place. And we highly recommend the site walk. It's a real quick walk for you and would really be evident of the desires. It's the perfect spot for the houses.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Hare, could you be specific about what kinds of waivers the applicant would be requesting in this application?
When I first submitted, I'll even admit there's a lot of waivers.
Well, that's the way we like to have it, is
well
addressing things directly.
Yeah, and And basically, they all center around the fact that the RB zone, you know, is saying to me, you know, we can have 80,000 square foot lots, but what we want to do is maintain the rural character in this area. It's a nice little private drive. It's gravel right now. There's just meadow grass on either side, old apple trees flower in the spring, you know, nice big oaks. It's a beautiful little driveway. We wanted to maintain this driveway and just widen it out and leave everything as it is. We can't do that now, so the goal is still to maintain that rural character. And in order to do so, I have to really get a, you know, I have to ask for things like sidewalks to be waived. They don't want to pave the road. They don't want a 20-foot wide roadway paved through there. They want it to be gravel. Curbing. And let's see, underground, you know, pipe drainage that you see in subdivisions really isn't necessary out there. The drainage isn't, there's no signs of erosion out there now. It's not generating the kind of water that catch basin pipes are required to channel. And then the traveled way in the center of the right-of-way is only needs to be waived for probably the first couple hundred feet, just in order to take advantage of the fact that we have to move the road to make the site distance work in accordance with the Public Works Director. And we can't do both. So in order to blend the road down the little swale, it's got to be off the center of the road. It just can't be arbitrarily straight just to meet the right-of-way.
And how wide is the traveled way as shown in the plan now?
Existing?
No, as proposed.
20 feet. 20 feet. That's a 20-foot wide roadway, which we're going to pave the first 50 feet just because I think it's safety reasons. It's nice to get out on a Mitchell Road using pavement versus gravel, I think. And the only other thing that I'm a little concerned about are shoulders. I know that Steve Hardy doesn't want to waive shoulders, but in a gravel road situation, we have a 20-foot wide gravel roadway with 4-foot gravel shoulders on either side, which means we're basically going to have a 28-foot wide gravel driveway. Mm-hmm. And I think Mitchell Road's about 24 feet. So in order to keep it looking like a driveway, I've asked for shoulders to be waived. It's going to be built like a driveway. It's going to have the increased gravel depth that Cape Elizabeth has. But really what we'd like to do is instead of, you know, solidify it on either side with gravel, just, you know, mound up loam and seed it on either side so it looks like a driveway, acts like a driveway, but is 20 feet wide and services the, you know, the safety vehicles appropriately.
Are there, I know that underground utilities have been considered. Are they going to be required in this project?
Yes, I don't think that the Bottomleys have any intention of putting in like overhead lines, and that's going to be something that we need. As you know, we have Little John. Portland Water District has an easement through here. They have a pump station over here on Shore Road, and the line goes through here. And this whole plan, once I get a feedback from you guys tonight, has to go to Portland Water District, and we have to work through what we can and cannot do. They're just, all they want to do is maintain the cover over their pipes that they have now. We could put buried utilities through there. They just want to see it, and they have to sign off on it. So our intentions is to bury all the utilities.
I guess my only other concern that I'm aware of would be the road maintenance issue, just making sure that there is a binding agreement in place so that there's no confusion about who does what later on. With
correct.
Respect to maintenance.
Now, would you like to see that brought to the planning board, or would, you know, a condition that it meet the town attorney's approval? I just need to know whether I need to get Mr. Sinead to do it sooner rather than later. You know, I could call him tomorrow and get him going on it, obviously, tomorrow.
I guess I would certainly, you know, welcome input from other board members or the town planner, but as a general rule, I think that is what I have seen is a proffered document as part of the application to the planning board that can be referred to the town attorney if necessary and blessed so that he is sure that it does what is intended to do. But I would suggest earlier rather than later.
Sounds fine to me.
Yes, Mr. Emery.
One other question, just an observation, Brad. On both the plan that was in the packet that was prepared by, I believe it was prepared by Richard Manthorn, or did he just do the base? Doesn't really matter. And it appears as though it looks similar there. The driveway that goes, that's crosshatched going down a lot too, you've gone through a lot of explanation and work to make sure this
it's
is
very, rural very straight, isn't it? I mentioned that to him. It's a typical engineer's.
Wonderful landform there, so.
Yeah. It will be, Tom, that will definitely be the last time you see that driveway laid on straight.
I thought so.
I had a chuckle about that.
Any further comments from board members? Questions? If not, do I hear a motion?
Can Mr. Carlson make the
Mr. Carlson.
Oh, I didn't, but I certainly will make it. I'd be glad to.
So nice of you
one
to volunteer,
of my one
Mr.
Of my
Carlson.
Last acts.
For your last act, that's right.
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Peter and Marlene Bottomley for a private road to access two new lots located at 268 Mitchell Road be tabled to the regular January 20th, 1998 meeting of the Planning Board.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. Any further discussion? If not, all in favor, raise your right hand. Thank you. It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hare. Thank you, Mr. Bottomley. We'll see you in January. Well, I would like to take this opportunity to say before we adjourn that this is my last meeting, and I guess it's also the last meeting for Mr. Carlson, but I can only speak for myself. I've been on the board off and on for, I think it's 8 years, the last 8 years, and I have thoroughly enjoyed my opportunity to, or this opportunity, to serve the town of Cape Elizabeth in this capacity. I've very much enjoyed working with the other board members, this board and previous boards, and also with both Maureen O'Meara and Alice as the consummate professionals that they are. I think it really has been a distinct pleasure, and I wish you all well in the new year. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Carlson.
I have to back that up, of course, and I have a great appreciation for Maureen. I've been on several boards over the years, not here in Cape Elizabeth, but in other towns, and I cannot remember ever being so well prepared as I have been in getting some questions that are pretty dumb answered by Maureen with no questions asked. She didn't say, you should know that. She just gave me the right answer. So I certainly do appreciate her, and we have to tell the public out there, if they're still awake, that we are well prepared. And to Alice, of course, who is here and does what she has to do and does it so well. And thank you to all the members of this board. Attendance, I can't get over that either. We certainly have had a good record of attendance. And I can remember getting a pin for that in grade school, and I guess we all should have pins. And I thank you very much for my tour of duty.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Carlson. I would certainly echo your comments with respect to Maureen. It really has been a distinct pleasure to work with somebody who is so qualified and competent and dedicated. So, if there are no further comments, I guess I'll entertain my last motion, which is to adjourn. Anybody
so
got
moved.
One? So moved. Excellent. Well, you're really alive at the end of the evening. All in favor. Thank you very much. That's it.
I thought you were going to go to the workshop to make sure that the protege got jammed in as the next chairman.
No, I hardly know who the, I mean, it's Nancy Masterton and somebody, and I don't know who the somebody is. So I guess we'll need three if Ron is stepping down or has stepped down. So do we know who the third is?